Well, it was termed, Norman, through a journalist out here, because it was put on for Bradman and Bradman only. We found out in 1930 that he was a bit weak on the short rising ball on his leg stump. And when I was selected to come out here, there was a meeting in London organised by Jardine. I forget who else was there, but Bill Voss was there. Well, Mr. Carr was there, my not skipper. And they asked me if I could keep a good length and keep on Bradman's leg stump. And he says, of course you've got to be accurate. I said, do you think you can manage it? I said, well, we'll have to wait and see about that. We're quieting Bradman, but yet he still averaged 50 in the test, which is not bad, is it, to say he failed. But he did fail as far as we were concerned, because it, we always said we'd have given him 75 and had told him he was out. And been satisfied, really, would have, 75.
Because he averaged 56 in the Butterline series, but he averaged about 150 in the series before in 1930, didn't he?
He averaged more than that. He absolutely murdered me in England. I'm not ashamed to admit it, because he was so powerful. And there'll never be another one like him, I don't think. Mm. Impossible.
Well, you've just touched on what Bodyline was. You say that you bowled a leg stump attack, but the Bodyline term meant that you were bowling short balls more or less at the batsman.
Well, the illustration of that is my field hour. I had the field set. I had a short mid-off to save the one, and I had no slips, no gullies, a short gully to save the one.
Mm.
So I couldn't, and I used to go right to the edge of the crease and bowl across the batsman, and I couldn't bowl half volleys or on the off stump because I had no money on the offside. So I had to concentrate on the leg stump or just outside the leg stump, and I'd got to be on the short side, because if they were pitched up to anyone like Bradman, that they'd just have found that the open space is on the offside. And I kept a good length, what I'd got to do. And it was quite successful.
And the remainder of your fieldsmen were all crouched around the bat on the leg side, were they? Like a ring of fieldsmen?
I used to have five close in on the leg side, just round the bat.
Mm.
And they but as I was a fast bowler, I was a little bit always on the short side.
Mm.
And I could get the ball to rise more than all the other fast bowlers on the English side. How I did it, I don't know, because they're all in shoulders taller than me, but I could get the ball to rise higher than them.
Yes, this is what surprises me about you, Harold, that you say you can get the ball to rise and you're always a bit on the short side. Well, you are physically on the short side. You're about 5'7" and a half.
I was 5'8" and a half at one time, so I must have lost an inch.
Mm-hmm.
But I was very fit, Norman. I was 11'7" when I left England. And would you believe when I got back to England, I was 12'7"?
You put on a standing weight out here?
Yes, and I never had breakfast, I never had lunch, I never had tea. I used to have a good dinner at night, but I was fit. I knew I was fit too.
Well, that would have had a few Australian beers there, Harold, didn't you?
Oh, well, that just kept me going. That's what I used to have for my lunch. I used to have a glass of beer for my lunch and a cigarette. Tea time, a glass of beer and a cigarette. I also remember the drinks coming out here in 1932, and it was hot, and when the drinks came out, I went to everybody goes up, and I went up, and I had a look, and I walked away. So the skipper came to me and said, oh, the drinks are here. He says, aren't you thirsty? I says, yes. He said, well, there's some drinks there. I said, no, thanks. He said, well, what would you like? Oh, I said, a glass of beer, please. Oh, he said, you can't have beer out here. I said, no, I said, forget it. And I used to get one come out on the field next time the drinks came out, right in the centre, be a glass of beer.
A glass of beer, schooner?
Oh, no, you got me camouflaged in the middle. Yeah, because you know, the sort of squash, well, as you know, you've seen Linville and Miller and Lennon them ball. It's all stomach. Pick your arm up and it's all connected here. Well, squashing that blows you up and one thing or another, but I wouldn't touch it. I'd have a glass of beer, but not. I've never seen a fast bowler who doesn't like a glass of beer.
Descriptions of your bowling said that you're making the ball lift from only just short of a length. In other words, you get more bounce, even though from your short height, you were bowling when a ball which was not a bumper, as we call it these days, or a bouncer. It was coming out from short of a length to about chest high.
Well, they're all just on the short side and lifting a little.
Mm.
Then when I used to bowl the bouncer, well, then it used to go over the top. But I've never bowled as many bouncers as what these people are bowling these days. Never.
Actual bouncers?
Actual bouncers, and I own it. Actually, it too, but it wasn't my fault, either of them. I hit Billy Woodfull in the ribs at Adelaide. Well, he wasn't a tall fella, and he was crouching when he got hit, so it couldn't have been terribly high. And poor old Bertie Oldfield got hit at Adelaide. Well, that was his fault, because he turned to hook it and missed it, and he told me afterwards, he says he never saw it after it pitched. But little hits on the legs or thighs, I mean, I don't call them hits, but Billy and Thompson, then, they hit people these days, and there's nothing said about it. I used to get booed and jeered and everything. I used to get booed from start of play to finish at night. But that, to me, it just jeered me up, same as when they call Lily, Lily, Lily. That inspires Lily. Well, this barracking used to inspire me.
Did you like batsmen, or did you hate them?
I hated them, you know that. Well, I hated them when they got the bat in the hand, but I was friendly with them off the field. Because I was playing for England and they were playing for Australia. Well, it's up for one, two, but on top of the other one.
Because over in that Adelaide test, the thing that really riled the crowd over there was after you hit Woodfall that Jardine set your body line field. In other words, you didn't always have your body line field, did you?
No, two overs, sells three overs. Mm. And then they didn't want a captain because all the players knew. They knew after two overs what to do, and they just went there. And no, it was just unfortunate, that was. You see, keep on that spot on. You've got to be accurate, you see, and you've got to set a feel for it.
Yes.
Because if you suddenly say, if I had a ball on the offside, well, the ball on the offside or on the off stump, Bradman had just found the offside field. You see, I got 33 wickets in only 4.5 tests. And I think 11 or 12 of them was clean bowled.
I think the total out of the 33, if you take bowls and leg befores, were 18.
Yeah.
So that you're putting a lot of deliveries on the stumps. In other words, were you unnerving the batsman with your body line, and then your accurate straight ball was getting the wicket?
Well, I've tried to unnerve them, I will say that.
In reading about the body line series, I'm reading the history of cricket written by Johnny Moyes, as a famous Australian.
And he
said that Bradman, in trying to counter the body line tactics, would move away outside his leg stump when the ball was pitched from wide on the return crease and trying to hit you through the offside field.
Right.
But if you bowled from over the stumps, he'd come into his wicket and play in an orthodox manner. That was his idea.
Well, very rarely I used to go close to the wicket. Only for the first two overs of the new ball, I used to go right to the edge of the crease and bowl across them. Same as the left arm, a bowling round the wicket.
You're right out near the return crease.
Right, as far as I could go.
And that means not only did you have an ordinary line coming across into the batsman, you also had the cut coming as well.
That's right, I had an angle and then a little cut on the ball.
So how then did you straighten the ball up to hit the stumps?
Well, I probably bowled one straight for a change. And well, Bradman, I think I bowled him once when he went across too far and left his leg stump vacant.
You bowled Ponsford that way?
Yeah, I bowled Ponsford the same thing. See, they were probably sick and tired of being bested round the leg side.
But Stan McCabe in the first test in Sydney countered you by playing hook shots.
Ah, now, that's what I said, you see. Now, that first test match, I think they got 380. Stan McCabe got 187. Little Clary Grimmett came in and got 40 or 50. So if there were going to be any protest about it, that's when they should have protested. Instead of that, we went to Melbourne. We won that test, then we went to Melbourne on a docile wicket there. I was hopeless trying to get the ball up. And I think Australia won that one.
Yes, Bill O'Reilly played very well, didn't he? Australia won that second test, yes. Bradman got 100.
That's right.
Yeah.
He got a duck the first innings, by the way. And then we went on to Adelaide, and we won that. That was the when the all the trouble was, when it started up.
Now, you said in your book, Harold, and that a newspaper article, whether you wrote it or attributed it to you after the tour, you said you thought Bradman was frightened. That's a pretty tough thing to say about someone.
It is tough. Frightened. I don't think he was frightened to that extent, or in my imagination, because the other fast bowlers, he used to play them, but it was just that probably coming into his ribs. I think it was a little bit shaky, I'll put it that way, shaky a little bit. Because on that wicket to the oval, after the drop of rain, the ball was lifting without me trying to make it lift.
This was in 1930?
1930. And Archie Jackson, he stood up well, and I thought Bradman, well, the other people did, thought he was drawing away a little bit. But
back in Australia in the Bodyline series, that you sensed that by bowling these balls, which were just short of a length, rising up pretty quickly into the ribs, that you were disturbing him. Could you see a reaction?
I said I'd got a 50-50 chance. Mm. That was different to what I had in England. And because I was a lot faster than what I was in England on these wickets. And I was, as I told you before, I was absolutely fit. And, well, all fast bowlers should be fit. I mean, to bowl all day long. But I used to be as quick, Norman, at 6 o'clock at night as what I was in the early morning.
Yes, and a 50-50 chance of it better than 100 to nothing, isn't it?
Absolutely. 100 to nothing in England.
I'm very interested in Douglas Jardine. What sort of a person was he?
Well, he was ruthless. And I always thought he was shy, a bit shyish. Mm. And if he got annoyed, like he used to call out to him, he used to have a different coloured cap on.
Oh, the Harlequin cap, yeah.
And if it annoyed him, he'd have another cap on, change it at lunchtime and put another one on. He did all such as that to rile the spectators. And this particular match at Adelaide, when poor old Bertie got it, and when we got Australia all out, we got booed and barracked as we all walked into the pavilion. And Wyatt and Sutcliffe, they should have opened the innings. Well, automatically they started to put the pads on. And Mr. Jardine starts to put his on. So Herbert Sutcliffe, being the senior professional, he says, "What's the order, Skip? Are you altering the order?" He says, "Yes, Herbert." He says, "I think I'll come in with you." He said, "While the crowd out there's a fever pitch, so I think I'll go out first with you and keep them at it." Now, that fella, Norman, Tim Waller was bowling. He got hit all over his body. He got about 8-something runs. And when he came in, when he got out, he took his shirt and everything on, and you could see red blotches all over his body where he'd been hit, but he never flinched. As a ball hit him, he never automatically rubber train anything. He never flinched.
Well, you said he was a ruthless man, but he must have had a lot of guts.
He had got guts.
Mm. Did he hate Australians?
Well, it's hard to talk about a person that's passed away, but I think he hated the cricketers.
Mm.
But he had a good life, socialist, same as we all did.
Mm. But he had a drive and determination to win, didn't
Absolutely.
He?
Absolutely.
Yes.
Well, that's what you've got to have in tests, Norman, whether you're English or Australian. If you're going to play a test match, you're not going to play to win. You might as well never play.
Yeah, I notice you refer to him as Mr. Jardine, which is the style in those days. Now, you're a professional cricketer,
yeah.
And you refer to Herbert Sutcliffe as the senior professional. The attitude between professional players and captains was a lot different then to what it is now.
Yes, because today, Greg Chappell and all these, they're all equal. Equal in social life. Now, when we played, there used to be amateurs and professionals. Now, the amateurs, they never got paid any money. All they got was the expenses.
What I'm getting at here, Harold, is that you weren't in a position to disagree with your captain. You can have a private point of view these days, but in those days, the captain's word appeared to be law.
Well, you see, I was a coal miner and brought up where you respected elderly people and gentlemen, I'll put it like that. And gentlemen, and I've always advocated an amateur captain, and I still do, to get the difference between on the ground. You see, we used to look up to these amateurs.
Mm-hmm.
My old skipper, Mr. Kerr at Nottingham.
Yes, there's a sort of class distinction.
Well,
that's right.
It's class distinction. I've always used to call them Skipper, we used to get out with calling them Skipper, you see.
Mm.
But today, they're all equal.
Now, what I'm getting at here, Harold, is that were you bowling bodyline under the instructions of your captain or because of your own free will?
Well, I did a talk with the skipper, but bodyline was never... We call it leg theory.
Yeah. I've said that the thing there is that even if you didn't want to do it, if Douglas Jardine had said to you, "I want you to bowl this way," you'd have been duty bound to do it, sort of thing.
Oh, yes. Well, got to be honest, only what I've read in the papers and that, he refused to bowl it. Well, I didn't know that, and I was playing with him. Bill used to bowl with his legs side field, but that, I don't think it was as set as bad as mine.
Yes, because the difference was that Gabby Allen was an amateur and you were a professional.
Well, I think if I'd have refused to bowl it, he'd have accepted it. I'm not going to put all the blame on Jardine for that, but same as I say, you end up getting else chance with the ball.
That test match in Adelaide prompted the following exchange of cables. Firstly, the Australian board.
Bodyline bowling has assumed such proportions as to menace the best interests of the game, making protection of the body by the batsman the main consideration. This is causing intensely bitter feeling between the players as well as injury. In our opinion, it is unsportsmanlike. Unless stopped at once, it is likely to upset the friendly relations existing between Australia and England.
The MCC replied,
"We, Marylebone Cricket Club, deplore your cable. We deprecate your opinion that there has been unsportsmanlike play. We have fullest confidence in our captain, team and managers, and we are convinced that they would do nothing to infringe either the laws of cricket or the spirit of the game. We have no evidence that our confidence has been misplaced. Much as we regret accidents to Woodfull and Oldfield, we understand that in neither case was the bowler to blame. If the Australian Board of Control wish to propose a new law or rule, it shall receive our careful consideration in due course. We hope the situation is now not as serious as your cable would seem to indicate, but if it is such as to jeopardise the good relations between English and Australian cricketers, and you consider it desirable to cancel remainder of programme, we would consent, but with great reluctance."
Would the fourth test go ahead?
I said to the skipper, Mr. Jardine, because I could talk to him. I said, what's the team for tomorrow, skipper? He said, "I don't know yet, Harold, I don't know." I said, "Well, haven't you made up your mind?" He says, "Oh, no, so I've got to wait for a cable from England." I said, "What do you mean?" He says, Australia wants to draw out to stop the Ashes sort of thing, to stop the play. So I said, "I'm waiting for a cable from England." And I went to bed. I wasn't bothered whether it was going to be a match or not. I thought myself, well, I'll get a good rest. But anyway, it came, and I don't know the contents of it, Norman, you might know about that, but we played on next day, so somebody must have drawn back.
Yes, I think the Board of Control in Australia changed their mind about the contents of the cable about stopping the tour game.
Yeah, we won the Ashes. When I broke down here in Sydney, busted my foot, and I had to... I couldn't bowl, I couldn't finish the over. So Jardine says, "You'll have to finish it, Harold." I said, "Look, skipper, I can't. It's impossible." He said, "Well, you'll have to." I said, "All right." So I stood and just turned my arm over against the wicket, and Billy Woodfull just pushed the four back. Now, that's where I admired him, because he could have hit those balls anywhere he wanted. He just pushed them back. So I said to the skipper, can I go off now? No, he said, "No." He says, "Look," he said, "good to cover point. Now, that's the worst position in the field, but the field." I says, "Cover point?" I says, "I can't run after him, skipper." He says, "Go to cover point, let somebody else run after them if they pass you." I says, "Right, oh." And Ed Levanter went on. And I think Bradman must have lost his head. He went down the wicket and tried to hit him, missed it, and it bowled him. And then Jardine clapped his hands and said, "Right, oh, Harold, go up." Well, Don and I walked off the field with one another, and neither of us spoke.
Was the object of Jardine to keep you on the field, was that just a psychological effect to have you there on the field, that you could come back and bowl again?
Yes, he told me that a short while after, Norman. He said, "I couldn't let you go off, Harold, until we knew the extent of your injury." He says, "And if you couldn't bowl," he says, "Bradman might have, you know, carried on." But when I got into the pavilion, the masseur, I forgot his name, he told me straight away, "So you'll never bowl again until you have an operation."
Anyway, ultimately did.
I did, but I was still one of the quickest bowlers in England, although I'd cut my run down to half pace.
Mm. But the Bodyline series, of course, went way past cricket, didn't it? There was a lot of politics got into that in the end. I mean, there was a lot of...
No, there was no politics.
I mean, until later on, you know, wasn't it?
When I got back, yes, probably, but that's the only thing we heard out here when we had to wait for the... that cable from the embassy. That was the only politics that I knew out here. But when I got back to England, well, I realised that everybody was against me, for sure. Although I had my operation, I could have still, I was still getting 100 wickets in a season in England. But I wasn't, I knew I'd finished. I'd finished as a tearaway sort of thing.
Yes, when you walked off the field with Bradman in Sydney, that was the fifth test in 33.
That's right.
That was the last test match you played against Australia.
That's the last ball I ever bowled against Australia.
Were you sorry about that?
Well, in a way, yes, but on the other hand, Norman, I'd achieved everything I wanted to achieve. Because I came out of the coal mine, my ambition was to play for Notts. I got that. I played for England in England. I'd met the King and Queen in England. I'd met all the notabilities out here, the Prime Ministers, and I raised the headlines. I mean, I was entirely satisfied. Probably if I hadn't have broken down, I might have just faded away.
The ABC's cricket authority, Alan McGilvray, now discusses the famous Bodyline series with lifetime friend and former ABC commentator and colleague, Victor Richardson.
Now, come to my story on the 1932-33 Bodyline series. Was it as bad as we were led to believe out there in the middle, Vic?
I just don't know how bad you were led to believe.
Well, let's face it, there were reports going back from Australia about unsporting behaviour. That's how bad I believe.
Well,
that cable that was sent.
Yes, well,
that's how I'm taking it.
Well, I think we'll get into that as we unfold the story of Bodyline. I'm afraid it may take a bit of time. But it all started in a match in Melbourne, an Australian 11 against, I didn't play in this match, against the English side, the pre-match they used to play earlier, instead of the one side getting two matches, they played one in the other state at Anastasia Lynn. And they unleashed it there, the first time that Don actually played against them in a serious match. And it was never brought out again until the first test match in Sydney. I think in that match, Lyle Nagle took 8 for 32. And I think the Australians actually won that match against the English side. But let's go back a bit further. When I went over to Perth to meet this team, to play in a game against them, it was a combined side as they usually play over there, and I met this English side, and I asked one or two of them, as I'd met, known them in England in 1930, so I said to old Bill Vose, I said, what sort of a team you got, Bill? Oh, he says, not bad. I said, well, how will it go? He says, if we don't beat you, we'll knock your so-and-so heads off. I never thought of this again, it'll be playing in this test match in Sydney. Well, you say you heard reports of it. Well, I suppose it was the worst thing that's ever happened in cricket. It didn't in any way contravene the rules of cricket, but it did worse than that. It contravened the ethics of cricket. Mm. And I consider in the game of cricket that that is the thing which makes cricket, the adherence to the ethics. Every game's got rules. Rules have all been made because somebody's cheated at some time or other, haven't they? You know that in golf and all those other things. But the greatest thing in cricket is the contravening of the ethics. And it's been done in this, because, unfortunately, every ball that Larwood bowled after a couple of overs would be half-pitched, straight at your body or your head, and on the leg side were every fieldsman except the one who was fielding at cover point. You had 5 or 6 men in a close leg trap here, and one or two, depending on the batsman, out in the outfield. So if you defended yourself, you were caught in this. If you hit it over the top, you were caught. Mm. Which is, Stan McCabe got 187 against them in Sydney. And Stan will tell you that he was lucky or fortunate, but it was the most magnificent inning.
Mm.